1010 WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
We are back. This is every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB, the Frank M. Conaway Sr. and our show with co-host Tehma Smith Wilson. Attorney.
Good morning once again, Baltimore and beyond. Thank you for joining us this second hour. I am Tehma Smith Wilson, attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. If you need to contact us for any of your real estate or estate planning services, we can be reached at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation but you're not able to get through in the phone lines, please text your question or comment to 667-334-7242. And if you missed any of our past broadcasts, go to YouTube, type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up where you can share it and look at it on your phone, your computer, and your television.
And we have joining us now our other co-host, I call him the Dean, Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore. Sorry I couldn't be with you earlier, and I may not be able to stay with you long now. I'm taking a few days off, but I could not let this day go by without saying good morning to my favorite audience, and I hope you're listening.
Oh.
And good morning also to my co-host, Carlton, the Undertaker, and, of course, Tehma.
Thank you, Bob. We have with us Bob as special guest for just a few more minutes. He's got to go take the show. The very fine pastor of the new Shiloh Baptist Church here in Baltimore, Monroe and Clifton. The very fine scholar himself, the Reverend Dr. Harold A. Carter Jr. With us. When we come back to the phones, we're coming in this order. Marlon, Mike, James, Stephen, and Kimberly. But Dr. Carter, go ahead with your
sure, I was
comment.
Simply responding to the whole Trump connection with Christian nationalism, which has several what I'm going to call very important and positive tenets to it, as it's, you know, as a objective movement, it sounds good. For example, again, they would certainly affirm such things as strong education, family, government, getting the media to again report with some sense of objectivity and so forth and so on. But at the same time, the notion to return back to another day, a past day when, and here is a good word, and that's the word privilege. They feel as though that they are the privileged ones, that God has raised them up, and therefore America as a country or a nation under God should be controlled by them. And so we all are Christians, or at least have a certain faith. I know that there are people in our audience today of other persuasions. That's fine. Praise God. So forth and so on. But the white, emphasis on white, Christian nationalists believe that this nation is theirs. That's mm-hmm. the dividing line, mm-hmm. because they do not see us as the privileged ones. Wonderful tenets, but when they exclude us, right, when they don't want us to be around or they see us as inferior to them, that's the issue. I would certainly want this nation to be a Christian nation, or at least a religious nation in the sense of having some morality, ultimately as a preacher of the gospel, come to Jesus. But that's not always, you know, their persuasion, because they want to tilt it, they want to twist it, that they are the ones. And so when we rise, if we don't assimilate, but as we rise, they become threatened. So Trump has been brought in with a kind of a bully spirit to suppress us, to suppress those who do not believe what they believe, and to go back to a time and an era that pretty much excludes us.
Hey, Bob, since you just coming on, what are some of the things on your mind, or maybe you would like to comment upon what Dr. Carter has so justly said?
Well, let me. First of all, welcome, Dr. Carter. I'm glad you're able to,
Bob, the pleasure's mine,
to join us today.
God bless you.
And let me say further that I agree with your assessment, except I think your assessment is too limited. The notion of privilege, which is another way of referring to white supremacy, is not only embraced within the so-called Christian community, but I would submit is embraced largely throughout all communities, including, unfortunately, even the black community. I think that unfortunately, the movement that we call civil rights was perhaps knowingly and perhaps unwittingly endorsed and acquiesced to the notion of white supremacy, and they approached freedom for inequality for black folk as though, like citizenship, it was something to be afforded or granted by white people. Mm-hmm. Now, you can't, unless, if you have the authority to grant something, that means it's yours.
Right.
And if it's yours, that means you are superior to those to whom who are the beneficiaries of your benevolence.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, unfortunately, the whole civil rights movement, in my opinion, acquiesce to and embody that provision. I don't know whether you agree or disagree. That's just my opinion.
I would certainly concur. Listen, I'll even elaborate on what you just said and try to expand that a little further. Of course, you know, as a Bible believing person, and I've said this to our church family any number of times, and that is, in the last days, I guess Satan is described as shaking himself. Lucifer, whatever, shaking himself, because he knows that his time is short. And so what's happening from the white evangelical or the Christian nationalism piece or the new apostolic reformation movement, that's what we are seeing from that perspective. The enemy is shaking himself because he knows his time is short. And to that end, they feel threatened. That's why, in so many ways, they have to do what they are doing, because that threat, we are a threat, a big time threat. Minorities are a threat. They are losing their numbers. We know that percentage-wise, please forgive me on this one, but old, white, gray-haired, you know, Christian so-called, quote-unquote, leaders, you see this in the government, whether, you know, it's the Senate or Congress or whatever. And look at what we have to, you know, work with just for our elections coming up. I mean, that speaks for itself, right, where the presidential elections are concerned. And so they are becoming extinct day after day after day, and minorities are taking again, the increase of becoming more and more the voice of this nation, and they cannot handle that.
Tehma?
Yeah, can you give me some examples on exactly what the evangelical Christians are doing to hold minorities or black people down?
You're speaking to me about Tehma?
Either one of y'all.
I would say in any number of ways, certainly just the language that we talked about, in the political arena, there is the sense that, as African Americans, even where the Black Caucus is concerned, that if indeed they do not have the voice in the last, I'm going to say 15, maybe 20 years that was once as influential as it was in the days of civil rights or coming through those days of civil rights. It's almost as though, Tehma, that the African-American political leader is almost just rhetoric. Nobody really hears their voice anymore, as was once the case. You see it also in the business world.
So my question is, what are the evangelical Christians doing to hush the voice of Black politicians? Because I hear voices of Black politicians all the time.
And I'm not saying that, again, their voices are not being heard. Let me say that another way, that they don't have a voice. I'm saying that their voices are not as influential as they used to be because of the, I'm just going to call it a deaf ear to what used to be something that was once appreciated and even helped to turn some corners to get to where we are.
So how is that evangelicals' fault? I mean, Black politicians speak to Black people. I'm a Black person, and I hear Black politicians speaking to me all the time. So, I mean, I'm not deaf to Black politicians, whether it's the mayor, city council, sure, the governor of the state. I hear Black politicians speaking to me all the time. I don't see how evangelicals are stopping them from speaking to Black people.
Again, I can do all the talking I want to, Tehma. It's whether or not anybody is going to listen on the evangelical side as a white evangelical. My point is that there's a certain, I'm just going to ignore. I appreciate what you said, but I'll just ignore what you said. I'll let you put it out there, fine, but we're still going to do what we want to do. And that's the suppression. We have the liberty to stand on our soapbox. I'm not denying that at all. In fact, we have to appreciate even that. We have a bullhorn. But the evangelicals, white Christian evangelicals, are still going to seek to have their voice not only heard, but action will be behind it because of the influence that they have.
But isn't that what everyone does? Like, Black people speak to have their voices heard. Evangelicals speak to have their voices heard. LGBT speak to have their voices heard. The immigrants speak to have their voices heard. So how is the distinction
made?
With
the evangelicals, sure. With the evangelicals, it's not just, it doesn't stop there. Because again, their desire is colonization. Based on the way they feel as though this nation has been founded.
Yeah.
So what laws are they trying to institute?
And based on how they see statistics is showing that it is the browning of this country.
Right. They don't need laws per se. They just do what they desire to do because,
and
again,
my question
they are the
is, what are they
ones.
Doing? Like, I understand in terms of, you know, the language, mm-hmm, and they're giving you a sense and if this happens, but can you give me something concrete in terms of this is what the evangelicals are doing? They're passing a law to stop Black people doing this. They instituted this organization to stop Black people or minorities to do this. I mean, senses and language, they can be interpreted different ways, but can you give me something concrete in terms of what these evangelical Christians are doing or have done recently to stop African Americans in America from getting their voice heard or from following our African American agenda?
And the door would be shut again for the movement, Tehma, to appreciate, not necessarily anything specific in terms of their agenda, but to appreciate what we would want to have happen. For example, if indeed Michelle Obama wanted to run for president, which is what she's come out and said that she's not going to do, you would find, as was the case as alluded to by Carlton about 15 minutes ago, you would find a major assault against that desire from the white evangelical movement, because the power that even Barack was able to have was not appreciated. We all know that. It was a major struggle just for him as a person of color. And so even if his wife or some other person sought to ascend there, they're going to do everything they can, again, to shut that door. That's nothing new. That has been the case across, you know, the time for us here in these United States.
And I'm not saying that's true or false, but at the end of the day, you know, everyone is not going to like Michelle Obama. So whether the evangelicals support her or they try to shut their door, there might be other groups, religious or other social organizations, that might feel the same way. I mean, it's America. We mm-hmm. all can feel different ways, and that doesn't mean that we're necessarily out and, to get
and
someone.
That's where a part of the fallacy in terms of the argument lies. We're all supposed to be Americans. We're all supposed to have voice. We're all supposed to have rights, so forth and so on. And that's not to say that we cannot even project those. It's whether or not action is allowed or things are allowed to make a difference. And that's where the white evangelicals shut the door.
Well,
I don't know. So educate me on the actions that have shut the door.
I got a full board, but I also want to hear what Bob might have to say to what Tehma is saying. Bob,
I just wish I was there. Unfortunately, I've got to go. But Dr. Carter seems to be on the same track that I would be raising. Okay. But I would question what, if anything, would be considered concrete if what he has identified is not.
I said laws, or name some laws that they're trying to institute to shut down black people from listening, or some policies.
But you're skipping it. You're skipping a step. You're skipping a step of who's in the position to make the laws. That's the whole question. The whole question of supremacy presumes that those people currently in power were ordained to be in power and therefore are ordained to keep it. And that sense of being ordained to be in power is what results in also the sense of privilege. And it is much psychological as it is practical and physiological. It's not just something that you manifest by something you can put your hands on. It also is manifested mostly in a state of mind, a state of inferiority versus one of superiority, neither of which are tantamount to equality, as presumably. So when people talk about making America, the only thing I would diverge a little bit from Dr. Carter is I don't think Trump started it. I think Trump only cares about one thing, and that's Trump.
He acknowledged that he didn't start it. It started back with Falwell and him.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. I don't think he started it.
Yeah, he didn't start it.
The thing of it is, he will give audience to anybody who's willing to kiss his ring, evangelical mm-hmm. or otherwise. If there was a Muslim organization that said I love Trump, trust me, he would have them. He would accept their supporters. He doesn't care who supports him as long as you support him.
Or as long as they're American.
The evangelicals adopt and embrace the notion of white supremacy. Period. And which is also reflected in the so-called two major political parties. But anyway, Tehma and I will. This is a discussion that we have ongoing from almost on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. I wish I was there. I had more time, but I'm going to go. Dr. Carter, thank you.
You're here, man. You're here loud and clear.
Carter, take care.
The deal is, and I'll wrap up on this for the sake of having to.
Then we're coming back to
get to
line.
Another studio, and that is, of course, when I talk about the threat in terms of population, so forth and so on. It has to also do with the fact that the country, and this goes to immigration. You want to talk about laws, so forth and so on, but it has to do with the country becoming too pluralistic and too diverse. And that's a part of the issue.
Yeah.
But to that end, whatever the opposite or other view can do to suppress the brown influence, the black influence, they're going to try to do it. I mean, it's very simple. I appreciate the worldview or the American view that I think I'm hearing you suggest. But at the same time, those of us my age and a little bit older, so forth, have a different bent. And certainly a different feel to what our upcoming generation may feel and have a bent towards. We still open. I believe in Christ, but also, and in addition to being a believer in Christ, believe in inclusion, believe in diversity, and so forth and so on. But they are those again who only wanted to go, but so far, and then they're gonna, as they have been doing, put the clamps on it, or at least try to. But I think that, as we sometimes say, the toothpaste is out of the tube, and I don't think they can get it back, but they're going to do everything they can as they go down and feel threatened to not allow it to move any further, or to put the needle to be more of an open, quote unquote, Christian society, or even a society in general.
Before you leave, I have one question from the texter. It says, what do you say about those white Christians, say the Pentecostal faith, who speak out and do not think like their white evangelical counterparts? What can be done to help the next generation?
Praise God for those who do. And I say that they keep doing it. If we talk about, again, a timepiece, because there are actually several segments in the evangelical definition. As I alluded to, Pentecostalism, again, is another form of Christianity, so to speak. And I would say that, again, if you are a white Pentecostal, that you continue, as we all seek to do, to fight the good fight and to stand up against or to stand for those things that Christ would certainly stand for, and therefore God would stand for in the wider sense of our discipleship and faith.
Well, Doc, we certainly thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule, and I know your schedule is busy.
It's good, man. We're good.
You are invited back anytime you see fit to come back and carry this conversation even a little further.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it.
Full disclosure, Harold Carter Jr., I've always called him my little brother for years.
True.
His father and I were very tight. And I just love him and the Carter family. Give my love to your wife.
And that's mutual.
To your sister.
Amen.
And just let them know how much we love them. And he already knows if the Lord take me tomorrow or whatever.
Don't go there. Don't go there.
My services will be at New Shiloh.
Don't go there.
To hold the crowd. I already told folks at Gillis that I will be at New Shiloh.
Lord have mercy.
All right. But we certainly thank you, Doc. And like I said, you are invited back anytime
you
are available. And we continue this great discussion.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much. Thank you, Tehma. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you so much,
Carlton. Appreciate it.
All right. That was the Reverend Dr. Harold Carter, the very fine pastor of the New Shiloh Baptist Church, located on Monroe and Clifton. Now we're coming to the airways, and I want to thank everybody that held so long on the line. And we're coming in this order right now. Marlon, Mike, James, Stephen, and Kimberly. And once they get off, you can call in. Let's go to Marlon. Let's get this ball rolling. Marlon, you're on air.
Hey, Carlos. Mr. Carlos. Mm-hmm. Look, when I was coming up in life, I used to look on my wall and I used to see a picture of they said it was Jesus,
mm-hmm.
a God. And that picture was white. And eventually, as time went by, it took me some time to figure it out. When somebody had asked the term, I started listening to people like Farrakhan and stuff like that, said God had woolly hair and, he was dark skin complexion. He wasn't white. So see, when Carlos said that, how can they both pray, how can they both worship or pray to the same God? It's easy. The slave master was praying to the white God. And the black slave was praying to the real God. So that's how they came as a combination of praying to God. But at the same time, let me tell you something about the man that just went off. See, the man that just went off was breaking it down. What's the lady name there with you?
Tehma.
Right there. What's
Tehma.
Her name?
Smith.
Okay,
Tehma.
Listen to me for a minute. Not nothing against you, Tehma. I just want to break something down to you in reality. And I'm going to respect you at the same time. See, he was really telling you what's the real true deal, but he couldn't explain it to you in full. Because the reason why it was the conversation between you and him got confused. He was saying and telling and putting pieces and parts out, hoping that you may see it. But I don't think you've seen exactly what he was saying. I read straight through it. The reason why I say that, because look, when you got hard hitters like him, what I mean by hard hitters, respectable people that's got power. Okay, his power only limits to certain things, because if you get to talking, if he got a church, which he do, if he got white people to come there, he got black people to come there. If you speak the truth, the real truth about God, white people are going to be mad at him, because you know why? That is the truth. White people got that different God, man, and that's what they believe in, the fake one. We believe in the real one. You see what I'm saying? So most of the time when anybody got power that's black and they speak out, white people will come at them, want to take everything they got, want to ruin them. And black people that want them to speak out for them don't have nothing to back these people when they lose all of what they got. He might lose his house, car, job, anything. But he spoke out for us. He stood up for us. Why can't we support him and let him speak out the real truth at the same time? He won't lose nothing. You see what I'm saying? That's the problem with our black people that's got power, even in offices and everywhere else. They're scared to speak out because they don't want to lose. And then when they lose, they don't have backup. We ain't going to back them.
Okay.
And I think it's wrong that we mixed up like that.
All right, Marlon. We appreciate and respect your opinion. And appreciate
that's a true opinion, man.
Okay.
That's a true opinion. All right. We need to start backing those people.
Okay, Marlon. All right. Let's go to Mike. Mike, you're on air.
Good morning. How you all doing this morning?
Fine.
Good morning.
Long live Frank Conaway, brother. Long live Frank Conaway.
Yes. Yes.
That was my man, man. He started this thing, man. I really appreciate him. Every Friday, I miss him.
You ain't the only one.
Hey, I want to get into a little bit of, Dr. John Hendrick Clark is one of my mentors. And he stated that all religions, he said there are no exceptions, are all ego-driven male murder cults. And he said there are no exceptions. And he asked people to prove him wrong. So my argument is, and another thing I want to say, ceasefire in Baltimore is what we should be calling for every day. We got to stop pointing guns at each other, brother. That is not holy. That ain't spiritual. That ain't nothing. That's cowardly. So Baltimore, ceasefire Baltimore. I call for that. A beautiful city, man. I was born and raised there. Went to school there. Ceasefire Baltimore. So I just wanted to share that with you all this morning.
All right. Appreciate you. Let's go to James. James, you're on air.
Hey, how you guys doing today? This is James from Pennsylvania.
Hey, James.
Yeah. I wanted to ask the pastor a question, but he's gone. Now, if you go to the book of Jeremiah and say Judah is black, you go to the book of Lamentations, they say, this is as dark as a coal. If you go to the books of Paul, he was described as looking like an Egyptian. If you go to when King David was surrounded by the Philistines, he described the angels coming out of the flying machines as having bronze skin with woolly hair. You go to the book of Daniel, he described the Most High as having hair like the pearl wool and looking like the pearl stone. Would you look at a pearl stone and look bronze? I mean, what are we doing here? What's all the hiding for? I mean, the truth is the truth, and there's no way around it, you know? We're living in the last second. We've got to wake up. That's all I'm saying. I'll talk to you guys later.
All right, James. Let's go to Stephen, Kimberly, Ray, Tyrone, and we got a line open, 410-481-1010. Let's go to Stephen. You on air.
Yes, Mr. Carlton. I'd like to ask a question. I really wanted to ask the Reverend. When this Trinity, like it said, God over Christ, Christ in man, then it said man over woman. I'd like to know why they set to say man over woman, that she has to obey him or be her head. Could you?
Well, wait a minute. That? First of all, the Trinity is Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I don't know where the woman part comes in.
I didn't mean to say that.
Okay.
That's right.
All right. Now, go back to the second part.
Was,
let's go back to the first question now. Say, repeat.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because you kind of got it messed up there. So let's go back to the first part.
Okay. It says, God in Christ, Christ in man, man over woman, and woman over children. And they're supposed, a man is supposed to be the head of the woman, and the woman's supposed to obey the man. Now, I don't believe that. Is that right?
Is that right?
Yeah, I'm talking about the woman part.
The woman part. I'm going to let Tehma answer that part.
I don't know. I mean, look at the family structure, right? When you marry, right? Who should be the head of the household, in your opinion?
I don't think it's supposed to be a head. I think it should be a joint venture.
You don't think it's primarily the father or the male role to protect the family, to provide for the family, to lead the family?
Okay.
So, I mean, that's an example of the man being the head and leading the woman.
But let me ask you something.
I mean, you don't have to agree with it, but I just asked and you kind of agreed. So
let me ask you something, Stephen, to clear my mind up here, because I hear what Tehma is saying, and I partly agree with that. But are you saying that the woman should be subservient to the man in the relationship, or what is it exactly are you asking?
I'm asking, that's what they say. They said, I don't know, they got it out the Bible somewhere that the man should be the head, the woman, the head of the woman. I don't believe in that.
I just
must say as a man.
No, well, it's not about saying. I just gave you an example within a family household. Now, let me give you an example with the civil rights movement, right?
Okay.
Martin Luther King led that. Jesse Jackson was a part of it. They had a lot of men leading it. The women were as instrumental. You know, they didn't do it without the women. The women was the backbone. The women were organizing the boycotts, organizing the bus trips to march on. The women were a part of that. We worked together. But at the end of the day, it was led by a good group of African-American men.
In fact.
And they didn't neglect the women. They were working alongside of them, but it was still a leadership role for our black men.
In fact.
And it worked.
To piggyback on what Tamer's saying, I just got through watching the series of Malcolm and MLK. And when they talked about the civil rights movement under Martin, there were women like Ella Baker, and other women who were instrumental in that movement, but when they came up with the march on Washington, all of them, if I'm correct, I think there might have been one woman speaker, but then some people say there were no women speakers in that march on Washington, and women were the backbone of that movement. So, you know, you got it kind of both ways there, Stephen.
Okay. What about the obey part?
Well, I wouldn't even let the obey part be in when I got married. I told my pastor, don't put it in there. Now, I said that.
'Cause I know
as the man.
Out of my matrimony now. They don't say that no more.
Yeah. Well, some do. Some do. But when I got married 28 years ago, I told my pastor, do not include obey in there. That was my request.
That's what I think, too, also.
Okay.
But look, and the second part was about why they don't want to have women preachers. I think women can preach just as well as men.
Well, that's an easy answer to that. That depends on what denomination and what pastor do recognize women preachers. For instance, the church where Maybelle's funeral was yesterday and where she was laid out on Wednesday, the United House of Prayer, will not allow any women ministers in their pulpit. Now, it doesn't mean you can't come and say something, but you got to say it from the floor. You cannot get up in their pulpit. And there are other preachers in this town, which I will not call, and some of them Baptists, who frown on women preachers. Why? I guess they have a lot of them go into the Bible doctrine and try to use that just as we talked about the slavery thing. And some of them just don't believe, period. And you got some women out here who can out-preach a whole lot of these men preachers.
I know.
Naomi Durant was one.
Yeah, that's right. Because I remember that was back in when Paul was saying that.
Yeah.
When, you know.
Right.
3,000 years ago. When you could buy a woman for 25 cents.
Yeah. Thank you, Stephen. Appreciate you, man. All right. We got two lines open, 410-481-1010, coming to Kimberly, Tyrone, Mike. And we got two lines open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Kimberly, you're on air.
Hey, Brother Carlton, Pastor Carter, and Tehma Council.
Well, Pastor Carter's gone, but thank you for acknowledging.
Okay. You know what? I wanted to respond to that question where that caller asked about the slaves and the slave masters, us praying to the same God. And I wanted to, I'm no Bible scholar, but I wanted to give my understanding. I wanted to respond. When God speaks in his word about slavery in the Bible, it's not how we look at slavery. Oh my goodness, I'm so nervous. The way slavery, when you look at Abraham and Sarah, they had a maidservant, Hagar, that was her slave. And even in the Bible, when we owed a debt, you know, we had to take a legal stance and be slaves to that debt that we owed. So I just wanted to say the way that we can't go and interpret the Bible in our carnal mind. We have to pray and ask God to take us out of the natural and give us the spirit mind to understand the things that he's speaking. So, again, it's like, why would God tell us as black slaves and even Hitler with the Jewish people, you know, to obey those slave masters? That's not what he meant. I believe that the biblical text meant, even when we look at our job, you know, we are slaves to our bosses. And if you read the whole scripture, which is another thing that we need to do, that whole scripture talks about how we should obey not just to win the favor within their eye, but to also be like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. So you're not just doing a good job on a job, you know, just because the manager is around. You are to do a good job as if Christ is watching you. And it's like, we are slaves to our job. So I believe that.
Let me ask you something, Kimberly, because I'm not a theologian. I'm not a pastor. I ain't no minister. So I can't debate you about the Hagar thing. But do you really believe that during that time of slavery that the scriptures were not used to keep black slaves in line?
I think she's saying they were used, but they were used out of context, right?
What you mean out of context?
Yeah.
Like back in the day, in the Bible, right? If you owed someone a debt, say I owed you $1,000 and I couldn't pay it, I could option to be your slave.
Yeah, but slaves.
Let me finish.
Okay, wait a minute. But slaves in this country was different slaves. They were chattel slaves.
Let me finish.
Go ahead.
And I'll explain it. I could opt to be your slave, right? So in that context, that's the context out of the Bible. But like humans, we can take the Bible and contort it for our own special
belief. That's what
belief.
I said earlier.
Yeah, so they were taking that specific quote saying that you are supposed to be my slave and serve me, and they was using it to the current slaves in America, but they were contorting it.
Right.
So it wasn't the same meaning from the Bible, but they was using it.
Now I get a better understanding.
Yeah, they were using it to, since African Americans didn't necessarily have the Bible and couldn't read, you know what I'm saying? They couldn't say, well, that's not what that means.
The
slave owners are telling us the truth.
Okay, Kimberly.
Thank you for your call, Kimberly.
Thank you. Let's go to Tyrone, Mike, Gene, Ernest. And we got a line open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Tyrone, you're on air.
Yes. Hello, everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Before I begin, I would like to thank Pastor Carter for his leadership in helping to support Merrill Mosby. He allowed us to have our buses there at New Shiloh, and he allowed us to meet at New Shiloh. And that was very instrumental in us, you know, galvanizing the support for her. And we're not done, of course. On March 23rd, we're going to have a rally, a pardon petition rally for Merrill Mosby. And we're going to try to get thousands of signatures. This will be at the YMCA. From 12 p.m. That's located at 1609 Jude Hill Avenue, 21217. And I did want to add, I'd be remiss in not saying we forget about the Children's March that occurred with regard to the civil rights movement. The Children's March of Birmingham, on Birmingham, downtown Birmingham, in May 2nd, Birmingham, Alabama. The children from age seven to 18 marched. They left school and they marched, and they got dogs sicked on them, water hoses sprayed on them. When people saw that, President saw that on TV, he was so embarrassed.
Mm-hmm.
And that ended up causing the 16th Street Baptist church being bombed because that's where they organized. So, and all that attention generated support for the civil rights movement because they saw how blacks were being treated. And that's what when they came up with the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom of 1963. So that's the most forgotten thing called the Children's Crusade. People should look that up. But that's the most forgotten thing. The children are unsung hero of the civil rights movement.
Yes, they were. Yep.
Thank you for
your time. You're right, Tyrone. Thank you. We're going to Mike, Gene, Diane, and Ernest. Mike, you're on air.
Hey, good morning, everybody. I just want to echo what Tyrone was saying. Not only were the children instrumental in our civil rights, but also in South Africa. You know, when children mm-hmm. went up against that racist government with rocks and sticks, you know, and were getting shot. I mean, our kids were getting dog sicked on them and water hoses turned loose on them, but those children were actually being killed, being shot by that racist government. Carlton, I want to answer something you said. I believe that nothing's going to happen in Park Heights, and I'll give you the reason why. Upper Park Heights has the money. They control the government. Just like you talked about Yitzhak Fitzer being elected, somebody that represents them, and they put their money where their mouth is. Other ethnic groups in this country, we can see the Arabs going into politics now. Sooner or later, within 10 years, I believe we'll see Latinos, people from Nicaragua and Colombia, running for political office because they know...
Well, the Latinos are already there.
Well, I'm saying even in more numbers. I live in Baltimore County, and I'm seeing the number of Middle Easterners grow. We can look at what's happening in Detroit. You know, mm-hmm. how they've organized. See, and we... But with that comes entrepreneurship, comes money, you know, and I don't know why we just can't understand that nothing's going to get done. A vote is a vote. But I can tell you this much, Carlton, because, well, both you and Tehma are business owners. But, Carlton, say I promised you I was going to put an air conditioning system in your house, and you gave me a third of the money up front. And for 2 weeks you called me, and I dodged your phone call. But you saw me walking out of an alley or past a liquor store, and there was an alley there. You would probably, not you per se, because you're a good guy, but somebody would reach in that alley and grab a fifth of Richard's, an empty fifth of Richard's, and bust me in my head. I'm just trying to say you don't play with people's money, but a vote, I can tell you I tried. So until we get that together, I don't know where we're going to be, but that's my comment for today.
Okay. We're coming to Gene, Ernest, Diane, and Rasheed. We got one line open, 410-481-1010. Now listen, I don't have but 14 minutes, so get your point in quickly so we can go on to the next caller here. Let's go to Gene. Gene, you're on there.
Yeah, happy Friday, guys.
Same to you.
You said Latino. What's the difference between a Latino and a Hispanic? And my second question is, what's the difference between Easter and Passover? And what is a Seder?
We ain't got time for all those questions. Let's get to your point. Because you done asked three questions that is going to take time on, and I got a full board here.
Okay, so what's the difference between a Latino and a Hispanic?
That can be found on Google, sir.
Well, they're supposed to be able to educate our people.
Well, then give us the answer. No,
what is it?
Give us the answer. Educate us, please, sir. Educate us.
Oh, well, a Hispanic is a person who speaks Spanish, and a Latino would be someone like from Brazil who doesn't speak Spanish, but they are from, like, South America.
Okay.
So you didn't know that, did you?
I did know that, but educate.
But wait,
No.
Hold up.
Give information,
because
please.
Now you confusing me, because I know some South Americans that speak Spanish.
Yes, they do, a whole lot of them, but a lot of them don't speak Spanish.
So are they Latinos or are they Hispanics?
They're Latinos.
You just said Latinos are the ones that don't speak Spanish.
No, I did. I did not. Latino are people I'm sorry. Latinos are people. If you identify people who are Latino, then they can either speak Spanish and they speak other languages.
That wasn't said before.
Portuguese.
But we can.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Let's go on. Let's go to Ernest. And we got two lines open if you want to call in quickly before I cut it off. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Let's go to Ernest. On.
I think what...
Ernest, hey, you're on.
Hey, thanks. Good morning.
Mm-hmm.
The only I just was, well, since Dr. Carter said it, I think what he was saying, and I kind of agree with him, that if white preachers say something, the country listen to them. If black preachers say something, the country don't respond to them. And I think the only one they kind of respond to is Red Mouse Sharpton. But the real thing, reason I call, it's a holdover from last week since.
Wait a minute, hold on, before you get to that point, let me say this. The one person that white folk don't want to hear from is Al Sharpton. Now, right. The person that I would say...
We're saying the same thing, but go
ahead. The person that I would say that white evangelicals used to listen to as far as a black evangelical was T.D. Jakes until... And you see how they have muddied the waters of T.D. Jakes' reputation here lately. Okay,
right.
So go ahead. Okay. Go ahead with your point. I just wanted to bring that in.
I don't have a point. It's just, what do you think about your caller said when you asked her? I think she's a Christian, but she said she don't read the Bible. I'm not judging.
Oh, you talking about the caller last week? I think it was last week.
It was last week. I know it was, but I won't say the name. But I thought that was an interesting statement. And on the flip side, it could be a real transparent, honest thing. You know, she believes in the Lord and that sort of thing. But you don't sit down and read the Bible.
Well, so, that really confused me when she did that. That really confused me because when I asked her the very point about her not particularly liking Jews, but she was a Christian, and I'm asking her, wait a minute, hold it. You know, because the Jews wrote the Old Testament. Now, if you're a Christian, you're supposed to believe in both the Old and the New Testament. In my opinion, that's what I thought. So I was trying to get to it, and then she said, well, I don't read the Bible. Well, now...
But that's the thing, because that just lets you know that there are a lot of people who consider themselves Christian, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't know why they consider themselves Christians because they haven't read the Bible. You asked if she went to church. She said yes, but she just listens to the preacher. But at the end of the day, she said she was spiritual.
Yeah.
So, I mean, she didn't say she believed in Jesus Christ and she believed the Bible. Yeah. She said she's a Christian, but then she's spiritual. So, you know, a lot of people just use the word Christian, but they really don't know what it means.
You're right. Ernest, I got to go. I got a full line.
No problem.
All right, thank you. All right. We're going to Diane, Rashid, Dante, and Dwight. You're going to be the last person on for today. No more callers after Dwight. All right. We're going to Diane first. Quickly, Diane.
Yes. Good morning. How y'all doing?
Fine.
You know, you had so many callers to call in. I forgot my question I was supposed to be asking you. But anyway, you know, we have so much that we talk about, and we do get along to a certain extent, but we always say we don't, but we do. Even, like, if you look at it, sometime it used to be in the past, but now I understand that sometimes families have fights at funerals and weddings. But one time we used to get along at those two big events. You know, we didn't have no argument. We might have had a different disagreement about something, you know, the way the wedding and stuff going. But we're not alone. All ethnic groups do not get along, period. Whether you're Jewish, you know, because there's different denominational Jewish people that a lot of people don't know. They just think it's just one particularly. They got the Orthodox, they got the modern Jews, and then they have the new Jews, you know. So they're different ethnic groups that they are the same ethnic groups, but they're different levels of their belief. And it's the same thing with us. Why are we any different? It's the same thing with us because we all are human. First, we might not agree on everything, but what they do is come as a united front together in front of the whole world. We don't do that. We want to be divided, but we should come together as a united front. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, Doctor. And y'all you too.
Have a good weekend.
You too. All right. Going to Rashid, Dante, and Dwight will be the last caller for the day. Brother Rashid.
Yes, good morning, everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Carlton, because you know I'm on the front line with these young people, right?
Mm-hmm.
The more I got to go over to the University of Maryland, because we have three of our Baltimore City High School, we have three of our Baltimore City High School basketball in the state championship.
Mm.
We have Emerson, who won the state championship last year. Ain't nobody gonna beat Emerson. And then we have Carver. It's the first time ever Carver being in the basketball state championship.
Okay, all right.
And then all right. So Emerson's at one. Carver's at three. And then at six we have the girls, and that's the power girls. And guess what, Carlton?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to do all them games.
Okay. All right. Let us know next week.
I'm the hype man for the whole city, Carlton.
All right. Let us know next week what happened. Go Edmondson, because you know I am a Edmondson alumni. Let's go to Dante. Dante, you're on air. Quickly.
Hey, how y'all doing today? This is Dante. Right. Mm-hmm. With Immaculate Car Deals, and we educate our black people on automotive purchases. My first point I wanted to say was in reference to the evangelical situation. The reality of it is most of us don't understand our slave ships, just like Mr. Marlin said earlier, were evangelical Christian ships. So again, they don't have to blatantly have policies and things that they show that we can pull up, but they work in the shadows. They got the money. Outside of that, I also wanted to say, how do we punch back? What are we going to be able to do? The only way we can do it is by supporting our own businesses. The reality of it is we don't have enough businesses to combat with them. So our big millionaires and people with hundreds of thousands need to start investing and taking out, what's it called, the Black Wall Street thing. We need to reinvest in that from city to city all over the country. Thanks. Y'all have a good day, okay?
I don't disagree.
Weekend. Okay. Dwight, last caller for the day, Dwight. You're on air.
Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing? You have a nice show.
Fine.
The subject that I wanted to say is too long, so I'm just going to say hi to everybody and get off. All right? Y'all have a blessed weekend.
Oh, that's all, Dwight?
And don't forget the Easter program with Ricky Diller. Just go.
Wait a minute. The Easter... what's he saying? What's going on?
Go to Eric's page. And see what I'm talking about. I don't have the information in front. I won't give you no falsified information.
Okay. All right.
We don't have rehearsal till tomorrow. To Monday.
Okay. All right. Tehma, we got any winners in those tickets?
Yes, we have winners. I will send them out an email letting them know when they won and how their tickets will be sent out to them for anyone who missed it. It's an Easter play taking place on Friday, March the 29th. Friday, March the 29th, there will be two different showings. One will be at 12 and one will be at 5 p.m. noon. If you did receive the tickets, you will receive a text message confirming your win and requesting an address so that we can send you a ticket. Also, if you want to get a ticket, if you did not win today, you can go online to www.battlestageplays.com. Once again, that's battlestageplays.com, and stay tuned. Next week we will be offering two more winners tickets.
Okay. But beside that, those two shows on Good Friday, they are also going to do a show in April, I believe on the 29th at Set the Captives Feet Free, which is Pastor Karen Bethea's church. I believe that date is right. Next week I'll know for sure exactly the date. Closing remarks, Tehma.
Thank you for joining us today. Thank you, as always, for taking time out your day to listen. If you need to contact me for any real estate or business services or legal services, I can be reached at 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242. And as always, don't forget to listen or tune into the Coach's Game Time conversation every Monday at 1 o'clock on 1010 AM. Coach's Game Time Conversation, Mondays at 1 o'clock PM on 1010, or you can listen to it on your app or online live.
Featuring who?
Featuring Tehma Smith Wilson and Coach Butch McAdams.
All right. And again, the memorial services for Minister Gail Covington will be tomorrow, beginning at 10 o'clock, with the services starting at 11 at Liberty Grace Church of God, which is located Liberty Heights and Copley Road. And on Monday will be the viewing of Reverend Andre Hale at Shiloh CC Church, located at 825 Yale Avenue at Beechwood. The viewing is from 3 to 7, and his services will be on Tuesday, 10:30 wake, 11:30 funeral at Shiloh CC Church, 825 Yale Avenue at Beechwood. Reverend Hale is the father of First Lady of Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church, First Lady Nicole Gould. Thoughts go out to her family, her brothers and sister, and the rest of the family there. And, of course, I did announce the passing of Mr. Calvin Brown, instrumental member and member of the board, I believe, over at Maranatha Apostolic Church on 25th Street. And once we get those arrangements, we will be letting you know about them. Yeah, thanks, Fats, for engineering. We're getting ready to get out of here every week from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB. It's the Frank M. Conaway Sr. NL Show with co-host attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, attorney Robert Bob DeShields, which we hope will be with us next week, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. And as we say, and if you need our services, telephone number to call is 410-669-1738. And as we always say, take your hand with your ear, put it to the ground, listen to the grass grow. See ya! Don't want to be. Bye!
His mother goes to scrub the floors for many, and you best believe.
The new 1010 WOLB with talk in the day and soul at night.